The sample mean is not the only point estimate for which the sampling distribution is nearly normal. This video accompanies the discussion of inference for other estimates in open intro statistics. We will begin with a review of confidence intervals and hypothesis testing for nearly normal point estimates. Then we will think about non-normal point estimates and when more advanced methods should be used. We have seen the point estimate X bar with standard error denoted SE X bar can be used to create a 95% confidence interval for the population mean. A general interval based on an unbiased and nearly normal point estimate is the point estimate plus or minus Z star times the standard error of the point estimate. Notice Z star is selected to correspond to the confidence level. The standard error formula will generally depend on the estimator, and Z star times the standard error is called the margin of error. Lastly, notice we assumed the point estimate is unbiased. A point estimate is unbiased if the sampling distribution is centered at the true parameter value which it estimates. In other words, an unbiased point estimate is, on average, correct. Just as the confidence interval method works with many point estimates, we can generalize our hypothesis testing methods to new point estimates. Let's consider the general p-value approach to hypothesis testing by focusing on an example from medical drug trials. A drug called sulfapyrazone was under consideration for use in reducing the death rate in heart attack patients. To determine whether the drug was effective, a set of 1,475 patients were recruited into an experiment and randomly split into two groups, a control group that received a placebo and a treatment group that received the new drug. First, write the hypotheses in plain language, then set them up in mathematical notation. In our example, one possibility is that the drug is not effective in reducing deaths in heart attack patients, while the alternative is that the drug does work. Mathematically, we write the null hypothesis is that the two proportions are the same, and the alternative hypothesis is that the control group will have a higher proportion of deaths than the treatment group. We assess this by considering the proportion of patients who died in each of the control and treatment groups. Second, we must identify an appropriate point estimate of the parameter of interest. Our point estimate is the estimated proportion of deaths in the control group minus the estimated proportion in the treatment group, which is 0.025 in our example. That is, the death rate in the control group was about 2.5% higher than the death rate in the treatment group. Third, we need to verify conditions to ensure the standard error estimate is reasonable and the point estimate is nearly normal and unbiased. These conditions will change slightly depending on the type of data and estimator. In our case, we need each proportion to separately follow a normal model, and that the samples are independent. The fourth step is to compute the standard error, draw a picture depicting the distribution of the estimate under the idea that the null hypothesis is true, and shade areas representing the p-value. The exact formula for the standard error will be dependent on the data and estimator, but the picture will generally be similar. Most importantly, the normal curve will always be centered at the value conjectured under the null hypothesis. In our current example, we are testing a one-sided hypothesis, so only one tail is shaded to represent the p-value. Lastly, using the picture and normal model, compute the test statistic and identify the p-value to evaluate the hypotheses. Then, write a conclusion in plain language. We use statistical software to calculate the p-value in this example, but we could also have looked up the value in a table. Because the p-value is less than the significance level of alpha, which is 0.05 in this example, we say the null hypothesis is implausible. That is, we reject the null hypothesis in favor of the alternative and conclude that the drug is effective at reducing deaths in heart attack patients. Just like there are general procedures for appropriately conducting a hypothesis test, there are also common conditions when the basic approach to hypothesis testing won't work. The individual observations must be independent, and in experiments, we generally require that subjects are randomized into groups. If independence fails, then advanced techniques must be used, and in some such cases, inference may not be possible. Other conditions focus on sample size and skew. For example, if the sample size is too small, the skew is too strong, or extreme outliers are present, then the normal model for the sample mean will fail. This video reviewed general procedures for confidence intervals and hypothesis testing, and highlighted a few circumstances when our basic approach may not be appropriate. If you learned something you found interesting, share this video with a friend and visit openintro.org for more resources.